Good morning. I want to welcome you to Smithville Brethren Church. Good to have you here. Sue McConaughey wants to make a statement about the items here in the lobby.
I camouflaged my heart sticker today, okay? But just wanting to remind you that we are raising money for students in three countries. Who can name the three countries where they have we have schools that we're supporting? Come on, I told you. Cameroon, United States, and Kentucky. India, all right. And just so you know, we've been to India and visited and played games with the Indian orphans, and they so appreciate when they get money for their school supplies and they can go and get an education. Silent auction officially ends today. You got time to bid, but a sneak secret here. Those of you in choir and bell choir, you might want to sneak and get a last bid in before I present until I call who actually got the items that they bid on. So if you have any questions, catch up with me. And I just want to say thank you. So far, we've raised over $600. So glory to God.
A number of years ago, we started doing the Christmas Challenge, and the first recipients of the Christmas Challenge was an orphanage in Peru that a group of us traveled to many years ago. It was run by a fellow that I came across when I was in the Brethren classes. When I was coming into the denomination, they made me go to these classes so I would know all about Brethren history and theology. And if you want to know about those, you can ask Scott, because he went more recently than I did. But my colleague Italo was a part of that class, and that's where I got to know him. We'd intersect over those three classes over 3 years and really enjoyed him. Italo was in charge of this orphanage. He's the one who conceived it and really gave birth to it. But sadly, earlier this year, Italo passed away after some illnesses. And so we wanted to let you know. We thought we'd get more information, but we didn't. He actually passed on the 14th of January. And the orphanage is still functioning. His wife is there, and there's still children there in the orphanage. So his son is still there as well. So we want to be in prayer for Italo, the direction of that orphanage and the ministry there, but just wanted to let you know. On a happier note, we are having a primetime lunch coming up, so if you're over 55 and hungry, you'll want to sign up through our website. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the opportunities we have to celebrate your goodness, the ways in which we can partner together, whether we are just sending money or sending people to places around the world where people are representing you in their communities, or whether we're representing you in our community right here. We thank you for the opportunities we have to be a blessing wherever we are. Strengthen us, encourage us, be with the Abui family and the orphanage in these days ahead. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
How can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? I invite you, let's stand together and call each other to worship this morning. God forbid that I should boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I would invite you to take your hymn book and turn to number 337. We're going to sing Nothing But the Blood. You please be seated as you do so. Would invite you to exchange your hymn book for your Bible. Want to turn to Genesis chapter 12. We're going to be reading just the first five verses of Genesis chapter 12. As you're turning, I'm going to be reading out of a New International Version. You should be able to follow along, and then, as always, would encourage you to just mark your place there in your Bible. That will provide then the text as Pastor is preaching this morning. But Genesis chapter 12, we're going to read about the call of Abram. Remember that Abraham's given name was Abram. He is not Abraham until after he has children. So Genesis chapter 12, going to begin reading in verse 1. The Lord had said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all peoples on earth will be blessed through you." So Abram went, as the Lord had told him, And Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. He took his wife Sarai, his nephew Lot, all the possessions they had accumulated, and the people they had acquired in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan, and they arrived there. What I'd like to do is something a little bit different this morning. I would like to give you an opportunity to silently pray right where you are at. Jesus, you may remember, said about the temple that it was to be known as a house of prayer. And when the Lord's people gather, this should be a place where we come to connect with God, and especially through prayer. So what I'd like to do is to give you maybe 30 seconds or so just to pray about maybe something that's on your mind, and then I will close us. So if you would, let's begin our time of prayer with you praying silently in the pews. Father, we come humbly to worship this morning. We would ask that you would begin by cleansing us. We ask to be forgiven of all of our sin, both those that are known to us as well as sin that we have not yet discovered. We come this morning and we want our minds to be completely placed on you, so we have begun by placing a concern, a prayer request before you. We ask throughout the rest of the service that our focus would be on listening carefully to what you would say to us, that we might again see a glimpse of Jesus Christ on the throne, that no matter what we have seen on TV or cable news or read in the newspaper and in a magazine, that we again remember, you are in control. We ask, Father, for wisdom for political leaders. We ask, Father, that there would be peace in our community. We want to pray, Father, for those in our midst who have physical needs. We want to lift up Doris and ask, Father, that this week the doctors might be able to take care of the device that has been implanted in her. We would ask, Father, for Eileen, that her surgery would go well. There are many, many others, Father. We would ask that you would meet physical needs. This morning, Father, teach us how to love well. This week will be a celebration for many couples in the church. But Father, we would ask that all of us would learn how to love, whether that is a spouse or children, friends, co-workers, even enemies. Let us be like Jesus. Let us learn to love. Let us go beyond the golden rule to learn Jesus' rule, that the measure of love is not what we would want to receive, but what Jesus would do for us, or what Jesus would do in our place for somebody else. You have called us to bear the name of our Lord and Savior. Let us do that well, to bring honor to you. Thank you for these moments together as we corporately worship. Let it be just the beginning of worship for us this week. In the name of Jesus, amen.
to start our song today with a scripture. And when the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a small round substance, as fine as frost on the ground. So when the children of Israel saw it, they said to one another, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was. And Moses said to them, "This is the bread which the Lord has given you to eat." It is from Exodus 16, verses 14 through 16.
Thank you.
Winston Churchill once said that we create our buildings and then our buildings create us. It's always interesting to trace the history of a church with the physical building that they have. I know that Art has shared with me some of the changes that took place in this particular room. Evidently, didn't used to have the platform. At one point, it was more just out here in front. But all those changes, and those of you that have worshiped here for decades, you can probably go back and trace some of the changes. Wanted to share with you, at the last church I was at, they always went back to the changes they made in 1959. They talked about that was the year that they reversed the church. Now I know you're wondering, what does that mean to reverse the church? And particularly you'd like to know how Baptists reverse anything. So I'll share with you. So what they did was they actually changed the orientation of the church. It used to be that they all faced one way. They went through doing some remodeling. Folks came in then, and they were faced the opposite way. Now, this morning, we're going to do the exact same thing. I would like to reverse the worship orientation this morning. You have watched as Dee led the choir, and the choir was singing from here out here. And you appreciate it, right? You like listening to the choir. Well, that's the small choir singing to you, but I'd like for the big choir to sing to the Lord. So what I would like to do on this next number is for you to think, not for singing around you as an audience, but to sing to the Lord. And I've got a great number for you. In fact, I invite you to take your hymn book. It is my favorite. And you will need your hymn book because there are so many wonderful words, Carol was struggling to get them all on the screen. So take your hymn book. You want to turn to number 338. It is Wonderful Grace of Jesus. And as we sing, big choir, who's your audience? It's the Lord. That's right. Let's stand together. Let's sing hymn 338. And sing loudly.
Sing loudly. Walk. Grace of Jesus, great to the world my sin. Thou shalt become this bride. Taking away my burden, setting the spirit free. For the wonderful grace of
Thank you. Please be seated.
Better than a touchdown throw in today's game is the matchless grace of Jesus. We're singing with joy in our hearts about how God's grace beats out all of our sin. What a wonderful, wonderful message to be reminded of. Many years ago, I was at our national conference. One of the speakers was speaking, and he asked this question, which stuck in my craw for a while. He said, "Who would care if your church ceased to exist? Who would care?" He said, of course, the people in the life of your church would, the people who show up every Sunday morning, the people who are part of the ministries of the church, those people would care, but who else? Would anyone else care? And then he went a little further and he said, would anyone else even notice? I get a little taste of this every once in a while. Someone will say to me, you're the pastor, you're a pastor of a church? Where? I'll say, Smithville. And if they have a glazed look on their face, then I give them the, here's where. And they say, oh yeah, Smithville. Are you the, and they always name some other building. Always. I'm like, we're a good-sized building on the main drag. How do you not know? And then I describe the building like, I guess I know where that is. I guess I know where that is. Who would care? Who would care if Smithville Brethren Church no longer existed? Who would notice? Let's talk about this in terms of blessing. First, God's people are blessed. Genesis 12, 1 through 5, we read in Genesis, we're confronted with the blessedness of God's people. God calls Abram to leave his country, to leave his family, and go to a place that he's going to show him. He's going to give him promises, He's going to give him things like land. He's going to make him a great nation. It's going to mean offspring. And we know the struggle Abraham experiences through trusting in God and his wife Sarah and all that, where they're trusting in him, but God hasn't fulfilled it yet. Eventually, there's going to be a son appropriately born, and God is going to bless them. They're going to be a blessing to the people around them. In fact, it tells us they're going to be a blessing to all people. I want you to imagine a group of critics, a group of art critics, and they're standing around a brand new work of art, and they're debating and discussing the motivation of the artist and what the various pieces in the piece mean and what is the meaning behind them, what has motivated the artist to do these things. And ultimately, about three different versions come out because there's three kind of schools of thought about this particular piece that are being developed, and they're discussing it, and they're sounding all very smart and educated. And then out of the back of the crowd comes the artist. And the artist says, this is what I was doing. This is what I was trying to convey in this piece. This is what this element means. And this is what motivated me to put this element in. And the critics then are silenced because the crowd has had the benefit of the artist actually saying. God himself has come out of the crowd. And one of the great blessings that Abram experiences and we experience as God's people is that God has spoken. He has revealed himself. He has not left us to wonder, what is he like and what does he desire and what does he require of us? He tells us. He tells us who he is. He tells us about himself. He tells us about ourselves. He tells us about what he desires and what he requires. God, when he speaks to Abram, is revealing himself. It's very interesting as you look over other major world religions and systems of religious thought. You get an idea that there is some sort of higher power, sometimes referred to as a god or gods, and then you find out what do those gods or God require, and what they require is essentially for people to be good. Do good. It sounds like Santa Claus messages. He's watching. He has a list. He's keeping track. There's a balance and a scale, and if you don't balance the bad you've done with more good, then you're going to be in trouble in an eternal way. And so people in lots of systems of belief and almost naturally want to believe that kind of thing, but God has revealed himself to us as the artist stepping out from the crowd. Romans chapter 1, Paul speaks about how the creation has much to say about who God is, but not enough to tell us all of these things. We can see the complexity of the creation. We can see God's mighty and handy work, but what we would not know is what he requires of us. We would not stumble into knowing about salvation. So God, in going to Abram, reveals himself. And secondly, God also intervenes. God's creation is not begun and then left to its own devices. God is not, as some have referred to, as the eternal watchmaker. He makes the watch, winds it up. We don't wind watches anymore, right? Some of them we don't even put batteries in anymore, right? But the idea was that we get this system started and then it just goes. No, God is intervening. He's intervening because he goes and he speaks to Abram. He's intervening because he's doing something with Abram. He's gathering up a group of people. He's taking them to a land. He's making them receivers of his blessing. And then those are in turn to bless others. God has revealed himself to the creation. God has intervened in the creation, and God has also orchestrated the writing of the scriptures. He has recorded the things that he has done. Genesis is a recording of the things God has done. Moses writes 5 books of the Bible. We have 66 books in the whole Bible, Old and New Testament, and in these pages we have more and more revelation of God, and what a blessing it is to have it. These last several weeks in studying through the book of Proverbs, along with many of you, I've been excited and challenged by the word of God that I have been reading about how readily it connects to situations in my life right now. I mean, Proverbs is great that way. The scriptures are great that way because God has blessed us with his word. His living word meant to shape and change our lives. And I've had great conversations with folks who are studying along with us, who've had the same kind of experience about how God's word is connecting to them and how it's shaping and guiding the decisions they're making right now. But the greatest blessing that comes to the people of God is the blessing of Jesus Christ. The blessing that is the fulfillment of God's promise in Genesis 12, that God's people will bless all people of the earth. The nations will be blessed. Listen to what Paul says in Galatians chapter 3 about this, beginning in verse 6. So also Abraham, and Scott reviewed the Abraham shift. Abraham, same person, believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Understand then that those who have faith are children of Abraham. Scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith and announce the gospel in advance to Abram, quoting, "All nations will be blessed through you." So those who rely on faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. When Moses writes, "All nations will be blessed through you," Paul says, we were looking forward to this blessing of Jesus. Jesus came to the earth to do what no one else could do. The one righteous person dying for us unrighteous people. And so God, like the artist coming out from the crowd, explains himself. He tells us who he is. He tells us what he expects.